Hello everyone, DK Magician here. Today I'm bringing you a sort of somewhat different episode. Like, I'm in the middle of exploring like the Aeropolis stuff, but I'm actually not doing like anything in the story or revealing anything in this episode. This episode will be all dedicated to the lore of Mardek. There are a lot of stuff to read in this libraries, like there's a library and there's a museum. So yeah, this episode will be all reading those stuff. For the ones who are interested, they can watch it, which is what I'm going to do, watching and then commenting the stuff that I'm reading. For those who don't care about that, well, this episode is not for you. There are others that you may enjoy. So yeah, let's get on with it. Let's start with the museum, which is these like rows of books. So let's say what you say here. M.C. Franz. Mafon's Crazy Franz was a well-known classical composer of a strange thing on called music. Well-known M.C. Franz. What the hell? I don't know this. Well-known for his utterly remarkable, unremarkable pieces such as Hair on My Guitar String and Piano Sonata, Concerto, Symphony, Waltz, Sonata Again, Suite. Number 6498 in the CD key of D squared plus 4x plus 6. What? And other keys too. Probably most of the ones on keyboard actually. Thankfully he's long dead now. M.C. Franz. Yeah, I don't know what is the reference to this, but yeah, I'm gonna search that out later in the wiki. You may comment in the comment section if you know what it is as well. So, root magic is the name given to the fundamental magic that other magic spells are drawn from. It contains immense power, but cannot be usually directed tapped by mages. Magical spells are devised by manipulating various energies in unseenable but omnipresent dimensions that right within our own. That's not right. I don't know what that word is. Yeah, I'm not English. It's not my mother language. So yeah, I don't know a few things. Anyway, specific threads are teased from a writing mass of energy. Then their power is drawn on them when casting that spell. Think of the root magic as some kind of giant glowy ball from which extend many coaxed out energy strings, which themselves are split into smaller strings. And smaller strings still, these strings then extend into reality when the spell is cast. And actually, this is sounding like nonsense, isn't it? Truly, magic is beyond mortal comprehension. Suffice to say, however, that root magic is powerful indeed, and soaked by those who are covetous of such the great and powerful things. Root magic. That's probably talking about the Tauma elemental that everyone is like weak or strong against. Like, I mean, that's pretty much. Never mind, not weak or strong against. Like, it's not a pretty much user or all element here. Actually, one character can actually do Tauma elemental damage, but yeah. I don't know if it's that what he's talking about, but yeah. The Manta civilization. Ooh, this is interesting. There are tales that humans, reptoids, and all current sentient denizens of this world were not the first to build up societies. No, not by a long shot. We are merely building over the ruins of many dead races that came before us. One of those extinct civilizations was known by the Manta. A magically gifted, intelligent, philosophical race who sought to understand the cosmos. They develop impressive technology that can be only be seen in dungeons and museums these days. It is said that they are wiped out of the face of Belfan when a calamity fell from the skies. A mighty beast known as the Annihilator. It was unstoppable no matter what the Manta tried, and it destroyed their greatest cities one by one if ease. The greatest wizards and sages of the Manta gathered together to stop this threat. If they could, using their amazing magical skills, and their efforts reaped the reward. But it was not quite what they had intended. They managed to tear his spirit, its mind and soul from his carnal shell, hoping that this would at least cause the beast to cease its physical devastation. But this was not so. The body rampaged, wild as ever, wilder, some even say, due to its mindlessness, and the spirit lived on too, somewhere. The manta now had two foes. It is said that the annihilator had annihilated all that could be annihilated. It merely stopped and rested, deep in a forbidden secret dungeon, the location of which is unknown. Thankfully, it unleashed upon a world once more. If unleashed upon a world once more, it will spell the end of us all. That is for sure. There's a thing, annihilator, in this game. Interesting. We might actually have to fight that guy, probably. Flying discs. Through history, there have been stories of strange saucer-shaped objects flying through our cities. Our cities, our skies. What? Where did I say? Where did I read cities? You know, I'm thinking about cities of mantas. They have been called by many names: clouds, discs, flying saucers, mill wheels, plates, just to name a few. Nobody knows where they are from or what they want with our little world. Are they the chariots of the gods? They rise to watch us, to monitor us as we sleep so we don't misbehave? Probably not. Like every other bookshelf, this one contains only a single book of only a few paragraphs worth of text in it. What does it say? Oh, nothing important. You don't want to bother reading it. Really, okay? Trilobites. Trilobites are a species of bipedal sentient arthropod that evolved alongside humans. They are very secretive, so little is known about their culture, biology, or general way of life. As such, the remaining pages of this book will be devoted to crude drawings of my pet ghoul Susan. Isn't she the cutest? I love the humor of this game. Good and evil. Good and evil are just words to describe psychological constructs that are relative to specific cultures and differ between them. Such as what's good in our society's eyes may be evil in another's. Ho, what nonsense is that? Is this? Everyone knows that the good and evil are absolutes, largely defined by light and dark elements. We all know that any action can be definitely and unquestionably defined as good or evil, or neutral, regardless of circumstances, with no exceptions. Furthermore, we all know that people are born good or evil, and their life follows their absolute moral leaning without change. Why? This is just the way our world works, and nobody can tell me otherwise. Good, of course, generally refers to putting others before yourself, and evil is the opposite, putting yourself first. Neutral is a happy medium. What do you mean it all depends on circumstances? So you do insist on talking nonsense, my boy? What do you mean, who am I talking to? Bah, enough of this, I'm writing a book. Now, as I was saying, good is good, and evil is evil, and that is all. How do you know whether you're good or evil or wishy-washy neutral? Well, when you meet a stranger, do you gut him or give him all your generic gold coins? What do you mean, neither? Those are ridiculous extremes. I've had enough of you, shut up! Okay. Law and chaos. These books are about like good, neutral, evil, and then lawful, neutral, chaotic. It's about that square things like in that exist in personalities and in this game as well. Yeah, nice! Now I understand these shelves. It's misleading to refer to law and chaos. For what think we should call them order and chaos? Because that gives a clearer idea of what they're meant to mean. Yes, that's my proposition and everyone should follow it. For you see, lawful doesn't mean adhering to any specific laws and rules. No, it means following order, being predictable, holding to some code or preferring things tidy and planning things in advance. A lawful individual will perhaps have honor, plan strategically, be polite and whatnot. Chaos, on the other hand, is the opposite. Is of course the opposite. Chaotic individuals are free spirits, spontaneous, rarely keeping promises and doing what they feel like in any given situation. They're more moved by emotion than reason, and tend to have a general disregard for tidiness. Okay. The Chaosbringer. There are ancient writings scrawled in ancient ruins all over the world of Beltan. They speak of a Chaosbringer. A Chaosbringer. What do they mean? That we do not know. Chaosbringer. They will come. One day. Okay, we'll definitely learn a lot about this book. Let's make ourselves the hell out of here. And we have more bookies things here in this place. Deities. What are they? Deities are entities of a higher level of existence than we mere mortals. They are the overseers of the universe, eternal benefactors, watch, maintain and create the world of the creatures around us. They come in three major types. They are the higher creator deities, such as Yalort, who design the creatures and the worlds, shaping the elements of the universe to their desires. They cannot cause anything to appear. They can merely mold whatever what already exists. You know, there's a scientist that agrees with you. It's like Newton. Yes, laws of Newton and such, yeah. Thermodynamic laws, I'm talking about this. Nothing is ever created or appears or disappears or created or destroyed. Everything is transformed. That is the law. I don't know what the number of the law. Shut up. The mid-level elemental deities represent and have control over one single element in particular. They have supreme power over that element, so they are the ones that grant its use to the creators. They are the makers of the crystals. The lesser archetype deities are formed from minds filling niches that society needs to be fulfilled. They represent standards of what people should be, and as such are not omnipotent or perfect out of reach, or they exist as things to worship for certain specific needs. The names of deities should always be fully capitalized. However, the words to refer their followers do not follow that rule. Yalort's followers are Yalortians, for example, not Yalortians or Yalortians. This is because the capitals show the power of the deity's name. Derived forms are no longer the name of the deity and lose their power. Deities are non-physical entities and as such formless. However, when they interact, they tend to manifest as the same forms in order to be recognized. As most people have not ever seen a deity, though, any artwork depict them is speculative. A way of putting such a floaty idea into something so we can comprehend and recognize. Like the only dragon that is Yalort. Yeah. Worship. The worship of mortals is important to deities. None of them demand it, and there are no consequences for ignoring all the deities entirely. But there are rewards to be had for devotion. Worshipping creator deities devoutly tends to grant the ability to cast certain spells, such as Yalort's green lightning. The eyes of a devoted follower also glow with a solid color, seeing beyond that mere physical as the person becomes enlightened. Praying to the natural element deities tend to grant good fortune when in that element. Sailors may pray to Crisosuna, adventurers to Krog or Ovuk, pyromancers may pray to Volkus. Praying to the mortal elemental deities tends to be done out of desire to be more good or more evil. A charitable, well-wishing person may attend to Airendin for the strength to become a better, kinder person, while a villain may pray to Shumra, so that he does not get caught or defeated or upset by his evil deeds. The archetype gods exist specifically to be prayed for certain purposes, and grant slight but significant boons to those who ask for their aid. Lutinuet may empower a musician or a musical performer, for example, and Aishupi looks at Machu Picchu, you know. Bay assists a bizarre young man in asking a girl out of by giving him confidence. Oh, this is nice, could be useful. Okay, now. Okay, these books are probably all about deities, so let's learn about the deities of this world. Yalort is a higher creator deity, responsible for the creation of humans, reptoids, Belphan, and so forth, so on and so forth. He is represented by a large green dragon with black stripes, piercing red eyes and wings textured like the infinite cosmos. His symbol is the Eye of Yalort, and his followers are known as Yalortians. Yalortism is the largest organized religion in the world by far. Okay, like this guy. Look at his eye here in his shirt. This guy is a Yalortian priest. See? Deity Solak. Solak is a higher creator deity used to be worshipped extensively across the world. He was thought to be responsible for every sunrise, so people prayed and even sacrificed. That is bad. To him in order to bring the sun up the next day. Over time, people began to realize that the sun came up whenever they not prayed to Solak, and eventually most people lost the drive to worship him at all. There just wasn't enough point of wasting their time. This has left Solak feeling greater disgruntled and unappreciated, it seems. At least there are a small group of devoted Solakians in this world to this day, tend to follow strict lifestyle rules such as celibacy and isolation, like the priests that we just supposedly saved. Dream Realm Volume 1. The Dream Realm, also known as the Fig Realm, is that place where pixies are. I hate them! And those forgotten faces and stupid enemies that inflict you paralyses and such. Yeah. But now we're going to learn exactly what that place is. The Dream Realm, also known as the Fig Realm, is a layer of reality between the true astral realm and the material realm. It is where dreams and thoughts take place. Everything in the Dream Realm is formed from mind stuff, fig stuff, the stuff of thoughts and dreams. The layout imitates that of the material realm due to the fact that it's formed from the thoughts of mortal creatures. However, it is not as alive as the material world is, it is merely an image of our reality caused by our thoughts. This means that it can sometimes differ from the material if thoughts about the material change or are not strong enough. For example, you may explore a field in the Dream Realm which you know is empty in the material only to find it building there. It may be that this building was destroyed in material, but it lingers in the Dream Realm because the inhabitants talk so strongly and often about its existence, yet nobody has really talked about its non-existence very much. Objects in the Dream Realm do not move, they merely appear and then gradually fade, based on the talks of the mortal minds. Interesting. And this is the continuation. We enter the Dream Realm every time we sleep and dream, but don't realize it. When this happens, rather than wandering around the image of the material, we instead find ourselves in separate bubbles of mind stuff where our subconscious thoughts create unique worlds to explore. This is so interesting. So when you go into the Dream Realm, you are walking like in other people's dreams, you know, and thoughts and such. Yeah. Our conscious minds are feeble when compared to our subconscious minds in terms of creating the Dream Realm. We find ourselves in worlds that we do not willingly create while dreaming, yet if we try to conjure up an ideal situation, it tends to end in failure. I didn't understand this part. Our minds are small, we find ourselves in worlds that we do not willingly create while dreaming, yet if we try to, it fails. Okay. Basically, you can't force your dreams. I think that's what that meant. It is possible with training to walk in the Dream Realm while conscious. This is difficult and usually limited to certain skilled shamans and mages. Once there, it is difficult to shape the environment to your whims, despite the malleable nature of the mind stuff. This is due to how weak the conscious mind is when it comes to creating or shifting. It is technically possible to move physical locations by traveling into the Dream Realm, then out again to a different point. Warping works this way. You shift into an isolated pocket into the dream realm. Then your subconscious mind causes it to that reality to fold on itself, landing you at the destination point, at which point you slip out to the onto the material. It would theoretically be possible to travel across entire universe or even into other realities by using this method, but human subconscious minds are simply not strong enough for this. What that thing means is something that we are actually going to do, which you know, is using those circles, you know, to travel around places, like go into dream realm, then go into another circle and live in a different place. It is an interesting technique. Now this one. Oh, it's another deity. Deities, Quiqui, the Joker, is a chaotic, neutral, trickster archetype deity. He is generally depicted as a shadow of a blackbird wearing a top hat with a crooked, enigmatic disposition and a fondness for riddles and lies. His name is often cursed, more cursed than worshipped, though he can be popular amongst mischievous young children, thieves, or those who love riddles and games. So you like Kiki for playing Bardek. Galaris the Ever Raper is a lawful ever overseer deity. He represents death, both as an archetype and as a natural force. He has two roles: to collect the souls of the departed and to watch over the realm of the anti-life, a black void where those who live the evil lives must spend as long as it takes to atone for their crimes. He is depicted as a shadowy figure, wearing a dark, ragged robe, wielding a huge scythe which he cuts the silver cords of those on the brink of demise. His likeness is universally used in an artwork to suggest death or dying, either in the sense of danger or just death by old age. It's like our Death Draper, probably. Kikit, the Plague Bringer, is a true neutral pestilence archetype deity. It is depicted by an enormous beetle with a skeletal motif in which billows black clouds of locusts from his throating abdomen, destroying all in his wake with plagues and disease. It is called upon when someone wishes devastation upon an enemy, cursed when a plague is devastating people, and also called on for forgiveness in order to stop plagues or diseases. Okay. Gimpalarcanus, the Sorcerer's Taumaturge, is a true neutral archetype, a deity of universal magic. His depictions vary, but one of the most common is that of a wizard clothed in a hooded robe of stars, a long white tendril of a beard tumbling on the floor from the swirling void that is his face. That is a bit of weird. Universal magic. Okay. And he has a void for face. Weird. Okay. He is prayed to by spellcasters in general for greater success with their spells or for more magical power. Things like that. Okay. It's maybe like the Taume elemental deity, I think. Let's read this one. Deities, the Moral Ones. Shumbra, the Colignus Warlock, is the elemental deity of darkness. He is usually depicted as a humanoid, adorned in a ceremonial black feathers, with a blind head, a snout full of fangs, twisted into a malicious snarl. He is truly evil, truly evil. Oh, whatever. And deceitful, he is the shadow that lurks in the night. He thrives on fear and misery. He tends to be worshipped by trickster, thieves, and sadistic or selfish people, as he helps out people who do things for their own benefit without considering anyone else. Shumbra's antipodes are indeed an abstract deity consisting of a collective mass of poor souls. It's hard to picture it, as it transcends the normal dimensions, but if you were to try, you could think of it as a ball, An orb of vibrant light at the center being the deity's essence, with layers upon layers of smaller orbiting souls. Irendin is averse to selfishness. He favors those who put others first and honors them after that, if they so wish, by allowing their soul to join with it, becoming part of his mind. Interesting. Deity is the nature ones. So Volkus, the ever-burning flame, is the deity of fire. He is usually depicted as a humanoid with the head of a dragon or a lion or some other fierce creature. He is violent and unpredictable, yet grants his favor to pyromancers or any who seek to harness the powers of fire. Crisosuna, the graceful mermaid, is the overseer of things related to the element of water. She is depicted as a calm, beautiful maiden, sometimes with the tail of a fish, other times not. But she is serene and worshipped by those who want peaceful lives, or those who travel by the sea and wish to avoid storms. Hawuk, the Zephyr of Change, is the chaotic air deity. It cannot decide whether it is female or male or female. It manifests as either depending on its mood. It is prayed to as a god of travel, adventure and change, and such is the favor of adventurers who live on the edge of the winds. Krogrun, the stalwart titan, Krogrun, is the deity of Earth. He manifests as a golem, as a giant, a tree man, or similar nature spirits depending on circumstances. He prefers that life to be taken slowly, seriously, calmly, and worshippers tend to be the ones who agree with this philosophy. Okay. Now, others. Aishupi, it's actually said that's how you spell it. Akyofi. The Darling Heart Saint is an archetype deity for emotions such as love, lust, friendship and social gatherings, teamwork, fertility and other such positive bonding emotions. She is depicted as an intensely beautiful woman, with golden skin and hair, wings made of golden feathers and a golden wand which she uses to cast love spells. She is popular among infatuated youths who pray to her help in getting their first awkward relationship started. She is also popular amongst the motivators and partygoers. Aichubi's alignment is chaotic good. Okay. So you. Abomonatorus. The unconditional abhorrer is the perverse counterpart of Aichupi, a deity of greater hate than love. Though she is really worshipped by the sane, she does still have a lot of work. She is depicted as a direct counterpart to Aichupi, a mocker to the darling heart saint's glamorous appearance. Her wings are and hair are black and ragged, redder than gold. Her skin is pale or dark grey, and her figure is more skeletal than voluptuous. She is generally seen as with a frown, contrast to Aishupi's cheery grin. Abomonatorus is a deity of hate and loathing, but not of anger. She represents a cold, seeming distaste for things rather than a forceful, aggressive desire to destroy. As such, she is not evil, merely discontent. She hates evil as much as she hates good. Her name is used as an interjection of intense dislike. Saying "I hate you" may be harsh, but "May Abomonatorus glare at you" is a way of saying that you really, really and utterly hate that person's guts. That's what you are going to do next time you someone like bothers you. Say, "May Abomonatorus glare at you." Abomonatorus... I'm saying it all wrong. Abomonatorus' moral alignment is true natural, as she hates everything equally. Okay, she's like an evil deity, you know? Okay, this is just repeats itself, so now I know that one side of the library is the same as the other, I think. It's probably tasks about Abomanatoro's thing. Yeah. So, let's see what we have here. We're around halfway of this. Let's talk about Oneirus. Oh, I like this guy. Oneirus, the Dream Weaver. Weaver is the... He got his talisman. Remember, like, the talisman of Oneirus who travel around. So, he's a true neutral ethereal deity who has specific control and power over the Dream Realm. It is usually portrayed as a huge whale-like beast with iridescent skin like a shifting rainbow, which lulls to sleep and creates dreamscapes with his mesmerizing song. People pray to Oneirus for a good night's sleep and pleasant dreams, and often seek out his counsel when they're trying to interpret particularly significant dreams that they may have had. Okay. Reptoids. Okay, no more gods, now it's reptoids. Reptoids are a sentient humanoid reptilian race that tend to live in caves. They're rarely seen above the surface or around the human settlements. They tend to have a distasteful view of us and keep out of their way if they can. They are noble and honorable, valuing politeness, calmness of mind and strength of will and body. They're hermaphrodites. Every individual can potentially mate with one another. And they don't suffer any significant uterus effects from pregnancy, meaning that breeding for them is vastly different for how it is for us. Okay. The Sun Temple. The desert west of Aeropolis used to be known as Badlands. Rarely did people live a life once they entered it. Bandits killed them. Lots of evil bandits. There was a lot of dark influence in those parts, but nobody knew why. Partially to satisfy their bizarre religious desires to be isolated, partially because nobody else would allow them to do this anywhere near them, but also to try to solve this problem, some Solakian priests decided to build a temple to Solak in the Badlands. It took 10 years to build, but once it was done, the differences in the environment were strong and noticeable. The bandits became priests, and the barbaric reptoids became calm, polite, and meditative. This goes to show the power that light has to subdue the evils of darkness. That's a nice story. Shamans. The planet is a living creature, just like we are. It is just isn't of the same type of life as we are. While we have the blood and bones, it has magma and rock. While we have organs, it has crystals. It's like us as a mind and needs. Due to our vastly different natures, it is impossible for the planet to communicate directly with mere fleshlings. Yet, it often needs to tell us how we look after it. To solve this predicament, it uses shamans. Shamans are individuals chosen by Nader to be the planet's representatives. Its mouthpieces so that it is able to convey information to us. There is one per geographical region, and when one falls, a successor takes his place. Shamans do not volunteer to be shamans. That role is decided before their birth, but they don't know until the shaman they take over from dies. Shamans can live lifespans many times of those of mortal humans due to planets' energy flowing through them. They are also granted the ability to use nature magic and an innate geological empathy to understand what the planet wants. They don't talk with the planets directly, but merely know what it wishes, what it must be done. See, it's not like the shamans in Sony game. These shamans here are good. Don't you agree, Gloria, oh, I can't look at you. Oh, crap. Oh, I can. See, Gloria? Oh, I'm looking at your butt. Okay, sorry. Mediador wouldn't like that. So, I already seen this one. We have 8 more, I think. Let's see this one. More deities. Vgarklak, the Mauler of Bones, is a chaotic evil war deity, usually depicted as a humongous, wingless, bipedal dragon clad in blood-red plate mail, wielding a giant serrated sword in each of his four muscly arms. That would look like very powerful. It is a god of violence, anger and destruction, not of honorable combat between cold-falling warriors. People who pray to it have no qualms about fighting deity. Okay, you. Deity is Plomharg. Plomharg, the friendly and wet herd, is a neutral god deity of harvest and farming. Usually ignored by adventurers and thrill seekers, Plomharg is nevertheless a very important deity in this world. He appears as a humbly, jolly fat man, wearing whatever farming garments are common in the vicinity. He exudes no sense of dread or judgment, coming across as someone who just wishes the best for his followers. Farmers of the world over pray to him for good harvests, and if they are sincere in their motivation, then they are generally blessed by him without fail. Nice. Now, Lutinuet, we have already heard about this, I think. The Bard of Stars is a neutral good deity of music, generally depicted, yeah, we definitely have heard about it. The Bard of Stars generally depicted as a silver-blue octopus-like creatures with a different instrument in each of his many arms. A one-man band of sorts. That would look very funny. Imagine an octopus like giving a concert of something. Musicians tend to pray for it for luck in their performances, and it grants them an enthusiastic energy to play with deep emotion. It is also generally thanked when people are born with innate music talents. Okay, so Brumtiesel, whatever. The helpful listener is a neutral good friendship deity. She is similar to Aichupi in that she can be called upon as a friend, but while Aichupi is more of extroverted, woo, let's party inclination, Brumtiesel is more introverted and calm, a listener rather than a party. She's prayed to and called upon by people in distress, who need guidance in their life, who just want someone to listen to them, or who feel lonely and in need of comfort. She manifests herself as a meek young girl or a plump, elderly, respectable, I don't know what this word means. Okay. Mother figure, depending on which the prayer would feel most comfortable around. Both are friendly, calm, and not judgmental. They forgive and help no matter what is wrong. Alright, that looks like a good god. Let's see this one. The Astral Realm. When we die, our larval existence as a physical entity cessates, and we take on pure spiritual form. We ascend to the Astral Realm in preparation for a whole new kind of timeless, formless existence. The Astral Realm is a place of pure thought, pure aether, where anything is possible. Just imagining things causes them to appear. You can create whole towns with mere wishes. It's the realm that dreams happen in, except after that you're awake and in control. So you go here after you die. Of course it says, when you die, you go to the Astral Realm in preparation for the next existence. Okay. Necropolis. Though it is possible to wander alone in Astral Realm, making your dreams come true via beliefs alone, most people aren't simply thrust into the raw, open, chaotically withering wilderness of the realm. Instead, when they die, they ascend to a place in which their rich religion told them it will be waiting for them. Heaven, essentially. It is exactly as their religion taught. In truth, there are many of those heavens, known as necropolises. All the afterlife spoken of every religion actually exists. Ooh, that is very interesting. They range from serene places of pearl and gold, to blissful fields of flowers, to huge battlegrounds full of fresh monsters to slay. They are formed inside bubbles of the astral realm by deities and exist as a form of reward and a place of gathering for minds who believe in the same heaven. It is possible, once a necropolis, to live, to ascend to higher planes or to reincarnate. So, once at there, to live, to ascend at the higher planes or to reincarnate. But the time that souls can spend there is unlimited. Some never leave because they desire no more than what is there. Skilled astral travelers can hop between different necropolises as a traveler, an ability that offers them limitless powers, as it is said that life forms on other worlds have their own necropolises too. But skilled can travel and an ability that offers life forms on other worlds have their own necropolises. Oh, so you can, like, imagine we have one on Earth, and then let's say, for example, in like another planet very far away from here, some dude thinks that there is a heaven, and an astral like traveler can actually go from this heaven to the heavens of the other peoples. Very interesting. Now this one, the anti-life. The gods are not usually judgmental. However, guilt is a strong emotion. People are their own judges, and there are some who die full of guilt due to leading a life full of evil that they never really accepted. These poor, tormented souls congregate at a place known as the anti-life, a limitless black void of despair which is used for contemplation, seeking atonement. The duration that they spend in this abyss is all up to the individual soul. They spend as long as they need there, and for some it can be an eternity. The anti-life is overseen by Galaris, the Ever-Raper, who keeps a watchful eye all over who arrive. He doesn't punish them himself and makes them quite aware of how bad their actions were by intensifying their negative emotions like fear, regret and so on, to speed up the process, it seems. And the last one, reincarnation. We do not necessarily have to live only one life. It is true that we generally remember nothing from before where we are born, but that doesn't mean that there wasn't anything from before where we are born. After that, souls are free to roam the astral planes to satisfy their desires and congregate with others in a necropolis, but this goes on from for a timeless eternity. Boredom exists for some. Once they have literally done everything, there's nothing left to do. This is where reincarnation comes in. They can decide to start anew with fresh, empty minds, devoid of their old memories. They are still the same soul, but they do not realize it, not realize once born that they're replaying the game. Everything is due to them. After that, their memories of all previous lives are restored, and they know who they are once more. This often leads to souls reincarnating again and again. Okay. Oh, wait. Their memories of previous lives are restored, and they know... Well, so it means that if you die, then you will remember all lives that you had. That's... can result in someone very smart. It's a shame that people don't really know that, yeah? Okay. The reasons for reincarnating aren't necessarily due to boredom and a desire for a new start. However, some souls merely like the limitations of the physical toil so much that they want to return for another go. The reincarnation cycle can be never-ending, though some souls do learn all that they can possibly can from it and ascend to the next level of existence where a whole new reality beyond our comprehension exists for them to explore from scratch. Oh, so interesting. You see, imagine that perspective, like getting die and getting reborn again and again and again, and then in the end you go to a higher plane once you learn everything that you could learn. But yeah, I'll leave you with these thoughts. This was, you see, a different episode. You see me like progressing in the adventure as such. And yeah, this time, however, I am not going to go to the save crystal because, yeah, I'm not going to save as I did absolutely nothing in this episode. Crap, I like the colors of the of the library more. So yeah, that was all for this one, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you have enjoyed this sort of extra episode and learned a few things. I definitely learned a few things in this episode as well. And yeah, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you around for the next one. Bye bye.